So, welcome to the last session for the conference. I hope you had a good conference so far. Last session is about security and configuration in the cloud. So who of you still stores clear text passwords in property files, for example? So some of you one word about me. I'm come from Germany, so my English is not 100% perfect, probably. Working at a company called Novatech, we are consulting, IT consulting for software development. I have my personal Twitter handle, and also we Twitter on our company account for all topics around testing and security stuff in Spring. I'm a frequent speaker at a lot of conferences, for example, the last year the OWASP AppSec in Europe, and some German conferences as well. So our agenda today is we want to have some evolution on security today. So getting from our local redundant property files with clear text passwords, clear text sensitive data, using distributed configuration at the first stage, then going further with encrypted distributed configuration values, then still one step better using a project called Vault. I will give an introduction into that as well. And the final stage will be a combination of all the Spring Cloud Config project, which is quite new, just released some weeks before the Spring I/O conference. So in fact, the homepage was also released some days ago. So the link still was invalid some days ago for that project. So that's our way to go. So that's the original state when you have your Spring Boot applications running in the cloud without any configuration distributed. You have your application properties or YAML files, either properties or YAML files as you choose. Then you have the properties for different profiles in your application, so lots of property files with lots of redundant configurations. So in our projects, we always have that difficulty that we have it multiple times in each application. We have almost same properties distributed. And next problem with that is that we have credentials like passwords or sensible user data stored in our property files. There's a special topic on that. Who knows the OWASP top 10? Ah, quite a few. So this year we have a new one, 2017. So release candidate 1 is out. So nothing really changed on that. That's the bad news. So injections are still number 1. But we have a topic 6, sensitive data exposure. So that's the topic we are dealing today with. There are 2 new topics on the OWASP top 10 now. One especially is for unsecure APIs. They also recognize that we are doing lots of REST APIs at the moment. So they have a special topic now for that to also secure that APIs correctly. And the second topic is to make aware that all our applications are attacked all the time, and you have to test your applications with that attacking tools that are available on the market before the attacker does. So these are the 2 new topics on that list. So what is typical sensitive data? We have passwords, we have database credentials to access a Postgres or MongoDB or whatsoever. We have OAuth2 client secrets, for example, that has to be stored somewhere. Encryption keys of all kinds. We have sensitive user data like social assurance numbers or stuff like that. And we also have credit card numbers, for example. So lots of sensible data, not only in our property files, but as well also in our database storage. So how to deal with that? So that's a typical one. So my super secret password stored into the property file. Often it's the root password of a MySQL database or something like that. Yes. So the first stage would be to distribute our configuration properties into the cloud. So that's the Spring Cloud Config project, which deals about that. So as I said, externalized configuration in a distributed system. So you have a server that deals with that now, with your configuration. You have a HTTP resource-based API to access your configuration. It supports property file formats and also YAML file formats as well. And you can encrypt and decrypt already property files on the fly, at well as in the property files, in fact. We will see how that works later. So that's the architecture of such an environment. You have the Spring Cloud Config server here. The Spring Cloud Config server out of the box supports a Git repository for storage of your properties, and also a file store to store it. So in the cloud, usually you go into that direction using a Git repository. Because you also have the advantage to versioning your properties. So for example, you can also create branches for your different stages, like tests, pre-production, stuff like that for your configurations, and also can version your configuration for different releases, for example. So these are the advantages to have it also in a Git repository. You also have to make sure that your Git repository then is also not accessible by anybody. That is not allowed to. So, because if you can access that directly, then this has no value with the protection of sensible values. Then your applications just connect with that Spring Cloud Config server and get their property values now from that config server, and do not have local properties anymore. But you still can combine local properties with that config server properties as well. So it's no deal. If you have any questions, just interrupt me at any time. Yeah, it's quite easy to start with a Spring Cloud Config server. You just need, in fact, that starter here, that Spring Cloud Config server as a dependency. If you generate it via startspring.io, you get, in fact, this configuration with the reference on the Spring Cloud release train. I use the newest one, the Dalston release. So all the stuff that I present today is in that latest Dalston release included. The second easy step is just to have a new annotation to mark your Spring Boot application as a config server. So that's the second step, and the last step to have your configuration server ready is some configuration stuff. So this is the URI for your Git repository that it points to get the property values from there. Then you have a server port, so by convention it's usually the 8888. And then you have some security stuff. That's because you can also encrypt, decrypt values automatically via REST endpoint for that Spring Cloud Config server. And it's not of use if everybody can decrypt some values without any authentication beforehand. So that would be the easiest part, to get a decrypted value and just call that REST API to get the real value. So I will just move on. I will give a demo for that later as well, but I will combine it with also encryption, decryption on that Spring Cloud Config. So next step would be how to encrypt now our property values that we have in our files. For encrypting, you, as usual, need some encryption key. So the config server also supports symmetric and asymmetric encryption key. This is the easiest part. You just give it a symmetric encryption key to encrypt all the values in your properties. And this is the one with the asymmetric key configuration. You can use either a key store directly, or you can also export it into PIM formats and just use that one in the config server. Then, as I mentioned, there are endpoints provided by the config server to actually encrypt your values that you have to store in your property files. You just call that endpoint with the encrypt path. You have to give your value to be encrypted. And as I told already, you should also use security there so that not everybody can access that endpoint. So for encryption, it's not that problematic, but for decryption later on. So then what you get back is the encrypted value. You can also test it then vice versa to call the decrypt endpoint, give it the encrypted value, and you get back the decrypted value. And that's the critical point. You have to secure that endpoint so that not everybody can just decrypt your encrypted values. That's a point that a lot of people sometimes forget about. So how does it look like? So this is the way you would input your encrypted property now in your property file. So you have your key named secret key, then you have some special prefix called cipher with the brackets, and then the encrypted value follows on that. That is a sign for the Spring Cloud config server that it has to decrypt that value on the fly if he gets the property for your application. So time for some demo. So let's find the right one. So this is the config server. As I mentioned, we have that annotation here. We have some application properties for the key store. Then I also have my personal config repository hosted on GitHub currently. There I have some values. So my client I want to show in 2 minutes is my config client. So I have two property files prepared for this, one with a profile with an additional one, and the original one, the default one, which is retrieved for the default profile. So if I don't give any profile for my Spring Boot application, it gets just the config client properties. And if I give the development profile, then it also gets that development properties as well. So if we look inside, there's just a simple message with some value inside in that one property file. And the other property file with the development has a secret key inside that is encrypted on the fly now in the demo. So I just start a config server application. So that runs on port 8088 now. The other part is then the config client application. As I mentioned, the config server itself is is protected by basic authentication security currently, so that not everybody can access it. That's because my config client also has to give some username password. This is just for demo. Usually you won't put it in the property file. Then you have give it the URI for the config server. So that's in that case, that's the default one. So I just put it in for to make it clear that this is the URI, but you won't have to give it if you use the default one. Then what's important is the Spring application name, because that's the name for the application properties on the config server. So it finds it with that application name as defined. Then I defined just two values that I will show in a REST client. Just that unencrypted message, as we saw, with that key message. And I also will start it with the development profile, so that we also get that secret key decrypted to a clear text to be shown. I will just show it with some string. So starting that. We can check if we can connect the. So he prints out that he fetched the config from the config server. And we should now see. So that's also. So as you can see, we have that message from the config server, and we also have the decrypted value from the config server. So it just decrypted that value on the fly from our application, so that only the application can see the decrypted value and nothing else. You can also see that when you look into the health actuator health endpoint. So as you see, the secret key is not shown in clear text at the health endpoint for security reasons. So Spring Boot has some detection mechanism. If you name your key like secret or key something, then it always marks that as a secret value. If you name it some other way, then it might be shown as clear text. So it's also always a good idea to protect the actuator endpoint for environment also with some user password. So in current Spring 1.5, Spring Boot 1.5, even if you don't put your security dependency into it, all the sensitive endpoints are secured by default now. So let's continue. Oh, why did it? So that was the second stage to have the Spring Cloud config server with the encryption decryption, as you've seen. Next step would be the introduction into a product called Vault. As you can see, Vault means something like that, which you can typically find in your bank to get protected. As we've seen, we have still some problems with our approach with Spring Cloud Config Server. So you have protected your values now, but you have now a key, asymmetric key or symmetry key that you have. With that key, you can easily decrypt the value again. So we have some chicken egg problem always in the security world. So how to deal with all that keys that are inside each other. And one solution that makes the world a bit more secure is Vault. That's by HashiCorp. Maybe some of you know already the Vagrant product. That's also from them. And also Console is another product invented by that company. So what do we get from Vault? So we get from Vault a secret storage without any leakage of any key to encrypt or decrypt. So that's all inside Vault. We never get access to some encryption key anymore. We have something like key revocation. If some key is leaked, you can always revocate that quite easily. So if you get knowledge of some leakage of your key, you can revoke it easily. You have also key rolling, so you can just roll your key in some time slots so that you change the key frequently, so that that also decreases the attack surface. And then important stuff is also you have detailed audit logs, who accesses which secret data at which point of time, with some data also on the identity, who is accessing that key. So this is the architecture of Vault, the trust model of Vault. You have two trust boundaries, so Vault does not trust the authenticated client that much, and it also does not trust the storage backend, where Vault typically stores its encrypted values. So that's because Vault always encrypts the values on that direction, so it never leaves any unencrypted value into that storage server. You can use different backends for storage for the Vault product. You can use Console, you can use MySQL, Google Cloud Platform, Azure. You can also use Amazon Web Service, Postgres database, so lots of choices to actually store your encrypted values with Vault. And on the front end, Vault requires authentication of all clients, so no client can access the Vault server without any authentication. And it also you also should encrypt, have a TLS SSL transport security on your connection, so that nobody can read out the decrypted value there. So these are the trust boundaries around that Vault server, so that product. So what about the secret storage? So the secret storage is always encrypted with the advanced encryption standard algorithm, which is not known to be broken until now. You can also generate dynamic secrets. I will get to that point a bit later. So that's important stuff for database credentials, for example. So you have a rotating credential generation, for example, for accessing a Postgres database. Then you have detailed access control policies. So even if one authentication key somehow is leaked, then it does not leak the complete Vault storage, only some part of it that is secured with some access control policy. So nobody has access to all the secret keys anymore. So that's especially important if you have some administrators that shouldn't see all the credentials of all the complete IT infrastructure. And you also have some lease time mechanisms, so you can also configure automatic revocation of your credentials. So audit logs are quite important for that Vault. So as you can see, it prints out the key of the secret data, but never prints out the real value. So also the real value is encrypted in the logs as well, so no sensitive data will be printed out in the logs. But you get detailed information who accesses which path on that vault. So the important thing is that it's not active by default, so you have to configure it to switch it on. Then all sensitive data is also hashed. And you have different targets you can use. You can have a file as audit log. You can log to syslog or to some target socket. So authentication is very important for Vault. So the default one is just a simple token to access the Vault. I use that also for the demo today. But that's the most unsecure one, because if you have the token, then you can access the Vault. There are some others that are more difficult for attackers to get knowledge of. So app ID, for example, is a combination of, for example, the Spring application name and some IP address or MAC address to make it more difficult. App role is also a combination of user-defined stuff. Then you can also use a TLS client certificate to authenticate, and you can also use AWS, AWS services, or even your GitHub account to have authentication. So one important stuff, as I mentioned, is that the rotation of database credentials that is supported. Justin Smith of Pivotal had that sentence, rotate, repair, repave. I don't know who knows that sentence. There's a really good video on YouTube about that topic that just describes how to reduce the attack surface in the cloud for the attackers. And there are three different concepts. So rotate is an important one, to always rotate regularly your database credentials. So even if an attacker has knowledge of one credential, then it's not of long use, because it's rotated the next hour, for example. The same is for the repave. So this is about deploying your apps also frequently, quite new. So with that zero downtime approach on Cloud Foundry, for example, you can just easily redeploy your applications also every hour to some new with your new Cloud Foundry build pack and VM under that. So if any attacker has access to that, so next hour will be completely repaved and the attacker cannot access it anymore. And also the repair stuff is quite important, just to perform all that that security fixes on the operating system, on the build packs, and something like that. So that's done regularly by the Cloud Foundry platform, for example. So these three concepts reduce the attack surface for the attacker. So what can you do with Vault for that rotation? You can have dynamic credentials generated automatically for AWS, for example, for Consul, for MongoDB, and for all that usual databases you use, like MySQL, Postgres, Cassandra. So for each of them, you can automatically have created user credentials via Vault. So Vault contacts these databases and just generates new user credentials. So rotating ones, if you can configure at which time periods you have to rotate them, and which authorities are connected with that database credential. So for example, you can configure it just having read-only access or write access to some part of the database, so that you don't have to use the root user anymore for the database. RapidMQ, I forgot, and many more. So, how to work with Vault? First of all, you have to start the Vault server, so that's the first step, the easiest one. Vault supports also different stores, as I mentioned. You can easily start over with some development mode, which is not for production, of course, and you can also have in-memory configuration or file-based configuration, or even have some higher availability configuration using console, for example, as storage. After that, you have to initialize that vault. We will come to that later. Then you have to unseal that vault. So before you unseal the vault, nobody has access to that vault storage. So that's also urgency protection. If somebody has leaked something off vault, you can easily seal that vault again, and nobody can access it anymore. So if you have unsealed it, then it's ready for access. Then you can read, write values, encrypt values, decrypt values from it. So if you shut it down again, then it's getting sealed again, and nobody can access it, even if just run if it runs, if still runs. So how to start vaults? Vault is easily started with a vault server. Then you give some configuration. In that example, it's in-memory configuration, like here. Just store it in memory. Then you have to give it some address to reach that vault server. In my example, TLS is disabled, so don't use that at production. Just enable always TLS. This is some special property on Unix systems. You can enable an mlock that prohibits that the memory is swapped to some disk space. That's also protection from leakage of some sensible data if you look into some files that is swapped out. Because sometimes for demo purposes, I disable that because you have to configure some stuff so that also users without sudo can access that mlock. So now to initialize that that vault, you need master keys that are generated automatically. So without a master key, nobody can access the encryption key that is used to encrypt the values in vault. And to make it more secure, they also use a concept of shared keys. So to unseal vault, you can configure that you need at least, for example, two shared keys to enable the master key to open vault. So that's also a concept so that not only one administrator knows all of the master keys. So you need at least two different administrators to open vault. So like for example, the nuclear bomb. So not one person is allowed to push the red button alone. So that's a similar concept here. If you lose one, all your key shares, then nobody is able to open vault again. So these have to be saved very carefully. So this is what it looks like if you initialize that vault server. Then after that init command, you get your unseal keys printed out. So you have to store these keys safely. And you can give also a parameter how many keys are required to unseal that vault. So in that case, you need two of these keys to unseal it. You also get an initial root token. So that's that token for authentication. This is the root token, so you can access the whole vault with that root token. So that should also be secured carefully, because usually you give tokens to user-defined paths in that vault then later. So nobody should have the root access to the whole vault again. Then after initializing the vault, you have to unseal it. So just use unseal command with one of the shared keys. If you have configured that you use two shared keys to unseal it, you have to do that two times until it printed out that is now not sealed anymore. Now you can use vault for encryption, decryption. Before you actually can write or read values, you also have to authenticate with Vault. This is an example using the dead root token in that case. And if you authenticated successfully, you can read and write your secret data into Vault or read it from Vault. So with Vault Write, you give it some path to write your sensible data, and just the key value, you write your values to be encrypted. And with read, you just read that path and you get printed out all the values that are stored at that location. So time for some demo. I already started a Vault server. And if I now just check what's the status of that Vault server, it just tells me that it's still sealed. So I cannot access Vault currently. For this, I have to unseal it, just prepared so that I don't have to type that much. So that was the first key to unseal it, but it still is sealed. So I need a second one. So usually I don't have knowledge of both of the keys, so I will contact my colleague to unseal it with his knowledge of the key. So now it's not sealed anymore. Now it can be used. To actually use it, you have to authenticate with that root token in that case. So I've already put in some secret value inside Vault that will be used now for via Spring Cloud config Vault, as we can see now. So that's the typical usage of Vault without any Spring component. So if you use Spring, that would be the next stuff. That's also quite easy. There's a new starter called Spring Cloud Starter Vault Config to use Spring with Vault. So you have to configure some Bootstrap properties. Who knows about the concept of Bootstrap properties? So the Bootstrap properties come into place before the actual Spring Boot application really starts. Because if you need to configure your application, then you cannot use the application properties. That's too late. Because of that, they introduced the concept of the Bootstrap properties that are read earlier at the stage of starting your Spring Boot application. So you need some properties to access the configuration for your application. So that's because. For configuring now the Vault, you also have to tell Vault the location where your properties are stored, and this map is mapped in Spring with that again with that application name. So in fact, you can use three different approaches. You can use the usual one, the Spring application name. But you can also use this Spring Cloud Vault generic application name or Spring Cloud Vault application name. So one of these you can use to tell Vault which configuration to be read. And what is new, you can also give it multiple names. So these are actually the paths where you read the configuration values from your application now. So one path would be secret. Application one, and one would be additional keys. And this would be mapped to these paths now. So secret application one, secret application one if you use some profile as well. And there's also some default one. So application and application profile is always a default value, which every Spring Boot application using Spring Cloud Config Vaults always tries to access. So you can put your default properties into application path and your application specific ones on that mapped part with your Spring application name. So that's the generic mapping between those two worlds. So again, some short demo for that. So again, some simple, I have two clients now, Vault Config Client 1 application. Both are reading some secret key and in a value called foo. The other one is doing just quite the same. What I configured here now is I have configured special tokens. So these tokens that are configured now in that application don't have root access anymore. So Vault Config Client 1 only has access to his own path where he stored his secret values, whereas Vault Config Client 2 application has some other path where he stored his application values. So the bootstrap values, as you can see, we have application 2 as name here and test keys as a second path. You have to name what authentication you are using. Currently, I'm using token as mechanism for authentication, and then you have to give your authentication token. So this is the token, not the root token now anymore, but just a token with only a subset of the contents of Vault. So only to access the part that is interesting for the application. So it's just starting. So one part, as you can see here, this is the default location for each Spring Boot application, but I didn't give access to this location. So just to can you see that the that you can see that the permission is denied if you don't give any authorization for that location. The same would be true for the other one. That also only has access to some specific part. So so this would be application one with some MySecret key that's decrypted on the fly. And I have the second one running on 92 that has some other value for the secret key. And if I try now to cheat with a little bit and try to access application 2 context on Vault with application 1, then this should also be denied. So as you can see, we also have permission denied for secret application 2 now at the moment. So no secret key anymore. So that's how it works in general. if you want to use that rotation of database credentials, as I've mentioned, then you can configure additionally properties, because it's now important to map the properties that we usually use for Spring Boot. We usually use, oh, that's a typo here, should be named password. Usually we use Spring Data Source username, Spring Data Source password as properties for our Spring Boot applications. And now you map the properties so that the rotation of Vault knows which is the key for our properties that we have to be decrypted now. That way, this get also decrypted on the fly, and we can access our database with rotation of credentials. And there's also some other possibility to use not only Spring Cloud Config Vault, but you can also use in parallel your Spring Cloud Config server with different backends. You can still use Git for your unencrypted, for your usual values that are not having sensitive data. And you can in parallel use Vault as a second backend. For this, you just have to start your Spring Cloud Config server with another Spring profile called Vault, and configure the target addresses for Vault. And in your client, you have to give the token, for example, for authentication. So that's all, so that you can use also your config server using Git and Vault in combination. So hopefully we have a target reached. There is not a 100% secure solution. You still have to know authentication, like some token or some TLS certificate to access Vault. So you never get 100% perfect security. Also, Justin Smith has some other talk. I have referenced that all in the slides. He talks about knowledge. If anybody knows of some alien technology to secure all the keys, so he doesn't know of any such technology. But with Vault and Spring Cloud Config Vault, we get lots of steps higher to make it much more difficult for the attackers to access our properties that are having sensible data. So these are references for the talk. One that's about the cloud native key management. It's a quite interesting video on YouTube by Justin Smith, where he talks about how to securely deal with your key management. So the most secure solution would be to use hardware security modules, but these are usually quite expensive and not that flexible for our cloud native applications. So that's the drawback for that. But that's the most secure solution. So that's all from my side. If there's any questions. I don't know, not yet. As I didn't mention that Vault is still at early stages, so current version of Vault is 0.72. So maybe Oracle will be supported in the future, but still I will expect it at 1.0 version probably. Any further questions? Yes?
Then in Bootstrap properties, you're storing the token. So you can only steal the token for this application.
Yeah, that's what I meant with key management. So token is also only for demo purposes. It's more secure if you use, for example, TLS certificates or some combination of secrets, so that you don't only have a token, one single part. So you can also use AWS mechanism. They also have some secret administration where you can then also use multi-factor and much more efficient authentication mechanism. Okay. Any other? You had a question? No?
Regarding this database user rotation, and is it aware of existing connections, not to kind of break them in the middle? If I already have some applications with this created user, and then I need to rotate those credentials, is it aware of this existing deployed applications?
Usually you use a connection pool, so that connection pool that remain valid until you get new ones. Then the new ones will use the new credentials then.
Thanks.
So it would not be of any value if your application breaks each time.
So you had two pools, one with the old password and one with the new password.
Probably, yes. That depends on the pool you are using. Any other questions? Yeah. If any other questions are, you just can contact me via email, Twitter, and stuff like that. And all stuff is on GitHub. The samples and the presentation as well. Okay.